Ruby Bridges, welcome to Meet the Press.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you for being here. It's a real honor to be able to talk to you. I want to start off by talking about this beautiful book that you have written in which you answer the letters that children have written to you. You made history as a child, so it's very powerful to read this book. Why did you want to write this book, and why now?
Well, I've had an opportunity to visit schools for the last 25 years all across the country, and it was just amazing to me the questions that they asked, you know, some of the answers that I got from them. And then I started receiving just boxes of letters from kids and accumulated so many of them and felt guilty about, I can't just keep them forever. What am I going to do? So I thought about how great it would be if I could just show these letters to the world. And we decided that we should publish the book.
You touch on a range of different topics, everything from bullying to race to the environment. There are lessons here for young people. There are lessons for adults. What do you hope people will take from your book, will learn from your book?
You know, it took me back to being 6 years old and thinking about what I was going through. And I think we as adults, we underestimate the minds of our little ones, because I know that I was having these really grown-up adult thoughts and thinking about things that probably my parents never would have imagined, and had lots of questions about what was going on, you know, at the time, outside of my school, in my classroom. You know, it was really very powerful. I mean, I was thrust into the middle of a situation that no six-year-old should be put in. And I was really thinking about all those things. And so when I started to read some of these letters, I thought, wow, things really haven't changed all that much. We are still underestimating our kids. They are still concerned about grown-up issues. And I heard their hearts, which is what I said. And I thought, I'm going to publish these. And so we got so many letters. I mean, it was really hard to choose the ones that we wanted to publish.
Well, you talk about the experience that you had, the history that you made when you were 6 years old. We have all read about it, learned about it growing up. We've all seen the images, those powerful images. But take me back to what that was like for you when you were 6 years old. You were being escorted by U.S. Marshals into a school that was newly desegregated. You had to sit in a classroom all by yourself. What was that walk to school like for you?
I have to say that I know that we all watch that, and as adults, you know, we think of the worst because it was bad. But we're not thinking about it from a six-year-old perspective. You know, my parents never explained to me what I was about to venture into. The only thing they said is, Ruby, you're going to go to a new school today and you better behave. And I was concentrating on behaving. But as adults ourselves, if we really think about it, I mean, how would you explain that to your six-year-old? Would you actually say, you're going to go into a new school today, there are going to be people outside wanting to harm you, they're going to be throwing things at you and screaming, they really hate you, but you're going to have a good day, there are going to be people with you? You could not prepare your child by trying to explain that to them. You would only make the situation worse. And I believe that's what my parents thought, so they didn't bother to tell me. And living in New Orleans and being accustomed to Mardi Gras, I mean, you know, we see that during Mardi Gras. Huge crowds screaming and yelling. So I often say what protected me was the innocence of a child. I thought that day I was venturing into a Mardi Gras parade. So I wasn't afraid. It took a while before I really found out that the crowds were out there for me. And that happened when I finally had an opportunity to meet another child.
Tell me about that.
Well, kids were being hidden from me. There were some white parents who tried to send their kids to school with me, but they were never protected by federal marshals like I was. So they had to cross that picket line, and they were being attacked. So even if they were not racist, it would probably be very hard for them to send their child. But they did, a few of them. And the principal was part of the opposition, so she would take them and hide them so they would never see me and I wouldn't see them. But on occasions, I would hear kids, and I was constantly looking for the kids. I'd already gone to an all-black school and knew what school was like, and yet this was so different. She hid them, and my teacher was advocating for me. She was going to the principal and saying, you know, the law has changed. Kids are supposed to be together in school, and yet you're hiding them from Ruby. If you don't allow them to come together, I'm going to report you to the superintendent. And so that allowed her to take me to where they were. Me, being six, I was just excited to meet other kids. But once I got into the classroom and met these other kids, a little boy said, I can't play with you. My mom said not to because you're a nigger. And the minute he said that, everything sort of came into focus for me. That it wasn't Mardi Gras. That the crowd out there was out there because of me and the color of my skin.
What was that moment of realization like when you realized those crowds were out there targeting you, saying threatening things and hateful things to you, a six-year-old girl?
Honestly, the minute he said it, it felt like a weight lifted off my shoulders. Because for that whole year, up until that moment, I'd been trying to figure it out. You know, why is the school empty? You know, who are these very tall white men walking around on the playground? What are they looking for? Why can't I go to the cafeteria? I smell the food cooking. And when am I going to go to recess? So for a while, I thought I was being punished, but couldn't figure out what I had done or why I was being punished. So it was really, it was hard, you know, trying to figure it all out. But the minute he said it, it came together for me, and it sort of made things easier. I mean, I didn't have to search anymore or have all the questions, you know, these questions going on in my head. Definitely it changed the perspective of the crowd. You know, I thought about what my mother said. She would always say, oh, those people are crazy, they need praying for. And I would do that. You know, I would say my prayers before school.
You would pray for the crowd that was shouting hate at you?
Yes. And it was just listening to what she said.
What your mom said.
Right. And I remembered that, you know, if I had a nightmare and I said my prayers, the nightmare would go away.
After you realized what these crowds were saying to you, how did you feel going to school every day, walking past them? What was that like for you?
I would not really focus on them. I would block them out. And mainly because I loved school. I never missed a day. And that was because of my teacher. I had an amazing teacher who came from Boston to teach me. She was white.
Barbara Henry.
Barbara Henry. And, you know, there were lots of teachers who quit their jobs. They didn't want to teach black kids. But she came to teach me, and I soon realized that, you know, yes, she looks exactly like the crowd outside. And I was a little bit nervous about that in the beginning because I'd never been one-on-one with a white teacher or white person for that matter. So I can honestly say I was a little bit nervous about it.
What was she like? She would sit in a classroom with you alone and teach you, and you developed an incredibly close bond with her.
She was an amazing teacher. She made school fun. We would always do fun things. I knew that she cared about me. She made me feel safe. she tried really, really hard to keep my mind off of what was going on outside of the school. I mean, there were days when if you opened the window, because we didn't have air conditioning, you could hear them screaming and shouting and chanting. And she would go to the window and close the window and say, oh, today we're going to have music. You know, it was little things that she did that made me love school. I knew that if I just got past the crowd, that it was a short walk and into the building, I was going to have a great day.
You were incredibly courageous, but it sounds like you think your teacher had an immense amount of courage, too.
Yes, she did, because she came into a city and was doing something that people did not want her to do. It was dangerous for her as well. You know, I hear her talk about it, and she wasn't allowed or able to really discuss her position with other people. It was a new city for she and her husband. She didn't really have any friends in school. I mean, she pretty much was ostracized herself.
I know that you're saying it took you a while to realize what exactly was happening, but once you did you feel afraid? Were there moments of sheer terror that you experienced growing up, going to school?
There's only one particular moment or an incident that would happen from time to time. And the crowd would bring a coffin. It was a baby's coffin. And inside, they put this black doll. And they would march around the school carrying the coffin. And whenever I encountered it going into the building, that's what frightened me the most. And it brought back memories of attending a funeral of a family member, an aunt, and her newborn baby in Mississippi, which is where I was born. You know, there were not funeral homes where you could actually hold a service. So you would have to hold the service in your living room. And so I remember when that happened, how scary that was for me as a child. So seeing the coffin again with the baby in it brought that back.
Where did you find the strength and courage to keep going to school every single day as a six-year-old, despite all of this hatred that was being directed at you?
You know, I was protected by the innocence of a child. I had an amazing teacher. I loved school. I knew I was going to learn something new every day. I wanted that. So I never missed a day. I mean, I knew, again, that it was a short walk, and when they would drive up to the school, I would think about something that made me happy. Christmas or my birthday, until I got out of the car and then into the building. So pretty much I ignored them.
You talk about meeting one of the individuals who verbally assaulted you when you were a little girl, and he came later in life to apologize to you for how he treated you when he was 17 and you were 6 years old. And you said he told you, quote, "I've changed my life. The only thing that I felt like I had not made right is meeting you and apologizing."
Yeah.
How did you feel when he said that? Were you able to forgive him?
You know, I honestly didn't feel like I had anything to forgive him for. I didn't know him. I didn't see him. You know, forgiveness is really for yourself. It's not for the other person. You know, he needed that. And I said to this is exactly what I said to him, you know, "I have nothing to forgive you for because I didn't see you. I don't know you." So he was harboring that and carrying that all his life, but he needed that. And I said, "If that's what you need, then fine, but I didn't even know you."
Where do you find the grace to pray for the people who are shouting horrible things at you and to have such a civil conversation with someone who was so terrible to you when you were so young?
I would often go back and think about what my mom said. even though she said it in a sort of just being funny. You know, these people are crazy, they need praying for. But I knew that when I had the nightmare, if I had a nightmare at night, I could say my prayers, the nightmare would go away, and I thought this would go away. So I would do that. And it purely comes from the innocence of a six-year-old, a child.
You have dedicated your life now to sharing your story, all of the lessons that you've learned in life with students all across this country. Why is that important to you?
I think that little girl is still inside of me, you know, saying, if you explain it to them, like a six-year-old, they'll get it. And I think it's important, you know. We all know that each and every one of our babies, when they're born, they come into this world with a very special gift. And that's a clean heart, a fresh start in life. It's us. We are responsible for what we see playing out today.
Your parents were as courageous as you are. Do you wish they had explained to you before the first day of school, this is what you're walking into?
No, because I would never do that to my children or my grandchildren. I would not do that. So I think they handled it the best way they knew how. And I think it was perfect.
You have now written this book as we are talking about all of these letters that you've gotten from kids all across the country. Is there one letter that really stands out to you?
Not really. They're very... those letters are from the heart.
Mm-hmm.
But there is a letter that's not in the book. We decided not to actually publish it. But it was a little girl who said, I had to be brave. You're my hero. You're so brave, and I had to be brave once. She said, I had to call 911 when my father was hitting my mom. And it just broke my heart. If you've ever been in a situation like that, you know, you would remember what that felt like and how devastating that must have been for a child.
That is devastating. Why did you decide to leave that out?
Because I also wanted kids to read the books and, you know, be encouraged about making change in the world. I thought that was a bit much. But writing this book has definitely helped me to realize that there should be other versions of it. Because there are other letters like the one that I just mentioned that we also got. And I don't believe that we should hide or cover up what's really happening in the world. It just needs to be in a different format.
Well, speaking of which, you say racism is a grown-up disease. Adults pass this on. How do you think adults should talk to children about racism, about bigotry?
I'm hoping that my books are tools to help them to do that. I mean, that's what I do. It is a conversation that we should have early on because you don't really know when they're going to be faced with it. As I said, you know, for me, it was the little boy. It wasn't the white school or the white teacher or what was happening around me. It wasn't that at all. I mean, I was innocent, and if you haven't been exposed to it, then you don't know what's happening. But when he said it, that's when it all hit me. So I think that you definitely have to choose the right time, but you have to choose the right tool. And that's what I hope my books will help to do in schools and for parents.
What do you say to parents right now about how to talk about some of those really difficult topics? Racism, bullying, which you address in your book, and some of the letters are just heartbreaking as it relates to that. Those are really difficult topics.
They are. But probably they're encountering it. You know, I have four sons, and, you know, not one of my sons ever told me when it was happening that they were being bullied. But they all have been. So it's probably happening. Mm-hmm. They may not be talking to you about it. Mm-hmm. But we have to find a way to address those very hard topics.
What goes through your mind when you hear these debates unfold all in schools across the country about what should be taught, what should be read, what shouldn't be, access to books? What do you think about?
Well, I think that's ridiculous. I mean, most of my books have been banned. And the excuse that I've heard them give is that my story actually makes especially white kids feel bad about themselves. Mm. My biggest fans are kids all around the world. As I just mentioned, all of the letters, all of the mail. I have little girls from all walks of life, different nationalities that dress up like Ruby Bridges. I found through my 25 years of traveling that they resonate with the loneliness, probably the pain that I felt, not having a friend. There's all sorts of reasons that they are drawn to my story. So I would have to disagree, I believe, but I can't swear to that. But I believe that it's just an excuse not to share the truth, to cover up history. But I believe that history is sacred, that none of us should have the right to change or alter history in any way.
When you first learned that one of your books was being banned, how did that hit you? How did that impact you?
I did not take that seriously. As a matter of fact, when I first heard it, I just ignored it and thought it was going to go away.
And it didn't.
It did go away. And I kept getting the questions about it. And I kept saying, they're particularly targeting my books because my books are so used in schools. I knew how popular they were. So I thought I was just being picked on and that I wasn't going to give that any energy to be drawn into that conversation, not knowing that I was supposed to be having that conversation. I felt like deep down in my heart, I was supposed to be having the conversation because a while back I'd done a TED talk about going against the grain. And it, part of that conversation was the fact that we needed to overhaul the books that we are using in schools, that we all knew that they were obsolete, that everybody wasn't represented in the books that we are forcing our kids to learn and study from. And so basically, when I couldn't ignore it anymore, that's pretty much what I said, is that if you want to have the conversation about banning books because of history, then let's really have the conversation. Let's talk about pulling all of the books off the shelves that we are forcing our young people to study from when we know that they are obsolete.
Are you afraid that not just your history, but the history of civil rights
Yes.
is being threatened in this country?
Yes. The truth is being threatened, no matter what it is. And I believe that we have to always err on the side of truth. Those things are what we live with today. The history, all the subject matter that they want to ban, it's happening in the world. We cannot live in a bubble, put blinders on like it's not happening. And if we think that we are actually fooling our kids by banning books, oh my God, where are we really? Because kids have computers, they have so much information at their fingertips. I have to go to my grandbaby to say, tell me what's happened, open my phone, do this, whatever. All of us. So we're not hiding anything from our young people.
Well, obviously one of your approaches has been to educate, and I know you've done that with your teacher a few times. What is that like when the two of you stand in a classroom together and speak to the next generation of kids?
It's amazing. We both have different approaches, you know. She's from a different time than I am. She sees things differently. I think it's important to also, you know, I have a great sense of humor. It's important to, you know, interject some humor into those stories so they're not totally afraid of what they're going to learn. But it's amazing. I mean, they have a common sense approach that somehow or another we don't anymore. So they get it. They understand it. You know, I've had a little boy try to explain to me once, you know, because usually when I'm in schools and I'm talking to them, I do role play where I become the opposition. Mm-hmm. And they have to convince me to let them in the schools.
That's very powerful.
Very powerful. I was doing it for 25 years, which is why I was in such demand. And so their job is to convince me that my law, and the reason why I say they can't come into my school, is ridiculous.
If you could talk to the six-year-old Ruby Bridges, what would you say to her on that first day of school?
I get that question all the time. I would just say, Ruby, it's okay. Don't worry. It's all going to be fine. It's going to work out.
And now, as you look out at the future, and given everything that you have written, given all of the work that you've done in schools, what gives you optimism right now?
And I get that question all the time, so I'm going to turn it around. Where would we be if we were a hopeless people? That I don't see a reason to get up and get out of bed anymore. There's no reason for me to be talking to you about this. It's not going to change anything. Where would we be if nobody had any hope and nobody wanted to do anything?
And you were just inducted into the Women's Hall of Fame. What was that moment like?
That was amazing. I mean, it was incredible to see all those different women who've done amazing things, still doing them. You know, all walks of life, different ages. It really made me feel good because, you know, sometimes you're tired and you don't really want to continue the work that you're doing. Am I really making a difference? But looking at them, they're still doing it. They're still doing amazing work, and it made me feel really good.
So many people, when they learn your story, they just think about how courageous you are. Do you see yourself as courageous?
No, I don't, because I don't feel that way all the time. I had a friend heard me say that once, and he said, you know, I heard you say that, but that's not true. I know you very well, and what I know about you is that when your back is against the wall and you're in a corner, you're coming out of the corner. And I thought about that, and I thought, I guess that is what courage really is. And he was right. I am coming out of the corner because I don't see anything changing if I stay in the corner.
Good. Is there anything else you'd like to say? Anything
no.
you'd like else you'd like people to know about your beautiful book?
You know, even though books are being banned, now there's almost 3,000 books, different subjects. It's not really about the books per se. It is about our right to be able to teach and educate our children the way we see fit. And no one should take that right away from us. That's really what it's about. Even though these books are being banned, you can still purchase those books and you can read them to your children yourself or make those books available to them. And that's important because we should definitely hold on to all of the rights that so many people before us fought and gave their lives to uphold. And this is definitely one of them.
Ruby Bridges, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Really appreciate it.
Thank you for the conversation.
Thank you for the conversation. This was so wonderful.
Thank you.
Thanks for watching. Stay updated about breaking news and top stories on the NBC News app or follow us on social media.